Hello everybody, if you are seeing this video that means you have searched for Riemann hypothesis in YouTube, and maybe YouTube has got this post as relevant to your search. That's why you are seeing me. Otherwise in internet no much people are there who search this kind of thing. So I'm going to share this video with you, all the people in the living in this world, to announce that Riemann hypothesis, one of the Millennium Prize problem, is solved. It is proved in positive sense. That means yes, a confirmatory proof I have arrived. So I would like to request all of you, whoever is viewing this video, so please spread this news and also see my work, assess it. If you see any kind of relevance to this with your work areas of work, then you can use it, because there are a lot of new mathematics has come out of this. Actually it's not lot, a few, I should say few, but there are a lot of implications. Actually let me be specific that it actually completes the mathematics we know today without Riemann hypothesis or number theory. It's not complete. Mathematics is also the this lackness actually is also reason for lots of physics mysteries which has remained unsolved for a long long time. And towards the end of the video I'll be talking about some scale gaps and all these things which may be been useful in reconciling the gap between quantum mechanics and general relativity, and we can fix the dark matter dark energy issue because it has got a direct connection there. Okay, let's start. It may be a series of videos, so 6-7 videos at least it will be required to take you through the whole work. Forgive me if my English pronunciation is not up to the mark, but because my native language is not English, but still I will be trying my best. I have given the title, numbers are naturally 3 plus 1 dimensional. Let me take you through the abstract. Riemann hypothesis stands proved in 3 different ways. To prove Riemann hypothesis from the functional equation, concept of delta function is used, similar to gamma and pi function. Other 2 proofs are derived using Euler's formula and elementary algebra. Analytical continuation of zeta function to an extended domain removes the poles and zeros of zeta function. Actually this part of here I should have mentioned that this is a this analytical continuation is a continuation from the side of harmonic conjugation. Hodge conjecture and BSD conjectures also prove using zeta values. Other prime conjectures like Goldbach conjecture, twin prime conjecture, etc. are also proved in the light of new understanding of primes. Numbers are proved to be multidimensional as worked out by Hamilton. The logarithm of negative and complex numbers are redefined using extended number system. Factorial of negative and complex numbers are redefined using values of delta function. So this talks about a lot. Here I have given a small disclaimer also, because it's about primes. We know that primes are used in RSA algorithm, and towards the end of my work, I have a feel that RSA algorithm is penetrable. It can be penetrated, although I have not looked into for in depth into the depth net into the depth of RSA algorithm, but a counter algorithm can be made. That's my point actually, although I have not tried it, because I abstain myself from doing something which will kill the internet system. Virtually it will collapse the total internet system. That's why I don't want to give a try on this, but a small recommendation to the RSA users that please move to some other systems, other kind of security systems, because primes are not safe. Is it's predictable. And the P versus NP problem, I have the answer that, although I have not proved it anywhere, but I can guess the answer will be, not guess actually, I have a gut feeling that the answer will be, it's that it can be solved in P, not even polynomial time. It can be solved if the algorithm is correct, if the problem is attacked from the right direction, then it can be solved in quadratic time, second order of time. Okay, this is our Riemann's original functional equation, and here we will be having one more conjugate form of this, which has got instead of gamma 1 minus s, I have got gamma of 3 minus s, because I have shifted the argument of gamma while defining a new function called delta function, which is nothing but a continuation of this series of functions, this trios actually, pi function, gamma function, and this new function I have named. I have suggested actually it can be named as delta function, because delta sits in between equidistant position from in the Greek alphabets. And there is one more minus sign in the front. That's the difference actually. This function is the harmonic conjugate of zeta function, and it will help us solving the Riemann hypothesis, and it will give a whole bunch of new results. Let us have a look on the contents. There is a short introduction, the Euler's work, then Riemann's work. Then I have directly went to the proof. Introduction of delta functions, alternate functional equation, an exhaustive proof of Riemann hypothesis, an elegant proof of proof using Euler's original product form, an elementary proof using alternative product form. Then infinite product of sum and product and sum of zeta function from induction approach. This actually I did to recheck my work, because no, not recheck. I should honestly speaking, I was actually impressed by Euler's work, which dragged me into this Riemann's work, and so my starting point was Euler's work. So I started from the induction approach only. This results actually I got fast. Then it was from the bottom to up, the functional equation proof, the exhaustive one, was my last findings, and the elementary ones I got one by one. Then we have recalculated some values of zeta functions. We have removed the poles, the trivial zeros, removal of pole, actually it's a duality kind of situation. Actually it can be retained as infinite, and at the same time it can be retained as a unit. So whichever way we like. But when our infinity has been regularized, and I don't see any point keeping it as infinite. So it's up to the mathematical community how they will accept this. Zeta results for confirms Cantor's theory. Here I got some similar feeling, because when I was doing this induction approach, I was getting some results which actually wondered me that why the real numbers in the real number line, why the integers are not so integers are not giving the result which I am getting more in the rational side. So actually I saw that there is a link here with the Cantor's theory, and it's a reconfirmation of Cantor's concept of countable infinities and non-countable bigger infinities actually. And Zeta results also confirm prime number theorem, because I have tried to establish a kind of duality within the unity concept. So this actually will be helpful in understanding primes and why the prime number theorem works, and that itself is based upon the idea of duality. So that's why we see everywhere now and then that twin prime occurs, and there are some representation like Goldberg partition, which is the minimum size of the Goldberg partition is 2, this kind of things. Then proof of Hodge conjecture, proof of BSD conjecture. These are not actually my direct work. I have used the, because these works are related to Zeta function. So whatever work has already been done on these two conjectures, I have used that and I have just closed it. Proof of other prime conjectures, as I said, twin prime conjectures, Goldberg conjectures, Legendre, Sophie Germain, Landau's prime conjecture, Bockert's conjecture, Collard's conjecture, Oppermann's conjecture. Yes, Collard's conjecture, I would like to say something, that it's the proof I have given, it's not a rigorous kind of proof, it's a very inductive approach proof. But I think after my total understanding of the number system, the proof is enough, because the Collard's conjecture actually doesn't give a strong mathematical statement, so it cannot be proved in a rigorous way. I believe it has to be simple, some kind of simple things that I did. We'll go one by one. On the application side, we'll try to apply this work, whatever we got from Riemann hypothesis, whatever results we got, we'd like to apply those on some areas of new mathematics which are in gray areas like complex logarithm. The complex logarithm is not complete today, so we'll try to simplify it, or we'll try to give a representation which are more meaningful, and then we'll try to fix the principal definition of principal logarithm also, which has a hole on the principal logarithm ln of 1. We'll try to fix that with the help of the extended number system like quaternions or vectors, vector algebra. Then we'll also define the negative logarithm out of this on the real side. Then factorial functions. As I said, that we have got a new kind of factorial function, which is I've named it delta function, that will help us to define negative factorials also, negative and complex factorials. And the whole process I have given a narrative description, and there are some suggestions on the scale gaps between quantum mechanics and relativity, general relativity, which can be useful in standard cosmology or as well as standard standard model of particle physics also. Then, okay, let's start. As you know, that this is the Euler's representation of zeta function. He found this kind of relationship in like a geometric series. Then he put into this product form, where the all the primes appear on the top, and on the bottom the even numbers series, which then subsequently was written in this kind of form, 1 upon this 1 minus p to the power minus s form. Riemann might have saw some connection between eta and zeta function, which he applied to start the analytical continuation process, and to some extent he was successful. But he could not finish the whole process, and when it comes to about the primes, he didn't have any rational reason for why the prime should be lying on the critical line, half plus I theta, and the now the answer is, because that's a kind of half is a kind of unity, where how will you say in the we have got seen this kind of thing actually when we first time made this trigonometric sine and cos functions. We have seen sine pi by 3 and cos pi by 3 give a modulus of 1 inside the square root of Pythagoras like thing. So that that oneness, actually it's talking about this unity also only. On the complex domain, this modulus kind of is also related to this work. We will see in detail further. And also he was stuck in the pole, which can be removed, because we need to go further into the analytic continuation, and these poles can be removed also. So let's start with the delta function first. As you know, that this is the representation of the factorial or capital pi of x. This is the this function is the name is given by Gauss. The pi of x has got this kind of recurrence relation. Then gamma of x, which is just one unit is less in the argument. Pi of x has got a recurrence relation with the gamma of x plus 1. Now we'll be doing this in the same manner. We'll be defining another one function, reducing the argument another unit, we name it delta function, delta of x. Now showing this, delta of x will have the same kind of recurrence relation with others, gamma and pi. So the gamma of 4 and 3, 2 will be 2. Here it will be, we have checked, but now it is entering the pole of first pole of pi of 0, sorry, pi of minus 1. Now it is entering the extended domain or negative side, which has also gamma of 0 is also pole. We can in the integral form itself, we can represent is at as an extension of unity, and these two units will be doing the same manner. So this way pi of minus 1 will be 1, and gamma of minus 1 also will be 1, and which eventually give a definition for delta of 0 to be minus 1, 1. Now we continue that relationship, and on the negative side we will be getting this kind of values for gamma of minus 1 is equal to minus 1. So that again will imply that my gamma of minus 3 is equal to half, and gamma of minus 2 is equal to minus half, which will imply that gamma of minus 4 will be minus 1 upon 12. This way the pattern will continue after infinity, minus infinity, sorry. Now on the functional equation, if we apply the limit of zeta function, now before we apply, if we multiply both sides of the functional equation by 1 minus s, and we can replace the gamma of 2 minus s, we can bring the gamma of 2 minus s. Now there, if we put the limit of zeta, limit s tends to 1, s minus 1 into s zeta of s, which equals 1, then we will be getting this identity, which is kind of a unit concept of unit circle, e to the power I pi minus 1, something like that. So we'll be continuing with this. One more step, we'll do some algebraic manipulation here, and gradually we'll be getting this thing, gamma of 3 minus x, 3 minus s, and one more negative sign will be appearing on the left hand side. So this is the alternate form of functional equation I got for Riemann's functional equation. We can view this as the harmonic conjugate of original zeta function, or we can view this as an analytical continuation of zeta function itself. I don't like the multi-valued zeta function term, so I have kept the zeta representation itself with the back in the mind that it is a dual kind of thing. So I want to see this as a continuum. Now on the proofs, it's actually easy now. Here if I apply the values, we will get a new set of values for my negative arguments, like minus 1 will be getting half, and half will be getting 0, as shown here. For half it will be 0, for minus 1 it will be half, and the series will continue.
continue, we'll be going. Here are two elementary proofs based on Euler's formula, and this was also Euler's formula and zeta function product representation in terms of primes, where we have not done much. Actually, we have just written the primes in the Euler's exponential form, and this product form, if it has to go zero, then any of the factors should be zero. So applying that concept, we could bring it down to the unit circle, and if we take the sum of this theta, all the theta series, then we can show the equality with the pi, and the radius is all unit radius is march to unity. Then we can solve the r and theta. Then plugging this r and theta, we can get that it's the real part of the critical zero line should be r cos theta, that is half. This is the most elementary proof. And also the with the alternate product form, we need to do some conjugate replacement first. Both numerator and denominator, then it will come into a form which will, if you want to prove zero, then we can track it back to again unit circle. And here a trick, little bit of trick is there. When I am multiplying this minus e to the power I pi with r e to the power I theta, actually I am, instead of adding this pi plus theta, I am subtracting the theta from pi, because it has got a negative sign in the front. And I have given the rationale also here, how we can do this. This is as a complex conjugate. Now if we solve this, then we will get again r equals to 1 and theta is equal to pi by 3. So here r cos theta is equal to half. These are the induction proofs. In proofs from induction approach, what I have done here actually is the same work of Euler. I continued. Euler actually he proved the product form, and now I continued from there and take the product of all the zeta function itself, zeta values itself. So zeta 1, zeta 2, zeta 3. Then something new emerges, and from the side of sum of numbers, from the sum side, and also the same thing I have done from the product side. So that also give me something else, which are simple arithmetic rules and the inductions. Then from the sum representation, I got 1 plus zeta 1, and from product representation, I got it zeta 2 into zeta 1. So that gives 1 plus zeta 1 equals to 2 into zeta 1. That means zeta 1 must be 1. Similarly, sum of all the negative zeta values also have got the same kind of half. And the here minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, this has got only zeta 1, minus 1 only. So this way, it's actually fit, give a new value for zeta minus 1, which actually is compatible with this new kind of representation of the alternate functional equation. And when I tried to check the Ramanujan's way, that also can be achieved. A similar kind of manipulation is required. Before I do this, here I have given a note, small note on the second part is calculated subtracting bottom from the top before doubling. So when you are writing the series, if you shift by one one place, then if we whatever results I am getting from subtracting, then we will be getting 1 plus 1 plus series, this series, and that same results before doubling we are just adding it to here. So that's in that sense it is two of this whole sum, double of all this whole sum. Now we can do the subtraction, which will give you minus this minus of this sum I, and the right hand side will be 1 plus 1 plus 1, which you know minus half from the zeta value of 0 0 0 of minus half. Then you do the sign change, we get half. This way we can rationalize zeta minus 1 to be half. Apart from the known one, minus 1 upon 12, which is given by Ramanujan also, it comes from the Euler's Riemann's functional equation. Then here I have tried to provide a counter example on Nicole Orosmans proof, because we know that zeta 1 is divergent and we have got some strong argument of put forward by Nicole Orosmans long before, I think around 1350. It's long before the even zeta functions conceptual, in 1737 I think. So here are the I have given it from two approaches, that how Nicole Orosmans proof can be set aside, we can ignore this to come to accommodate these new results. On Cantor's theory, actually, okay, let us break this video, then we will be coming back because the length is getting. So let us see you again in second part of